Well, Charles had a goal, and it was to be a millionaire. He determined he was going to become a millionaire. And that's not too unusual today, but he lived in the 1920s when $1 million was an enormous sum. Even when he married his wife Esther, he promised her, someday we're going to be millionaires. Then tragedy struck. 1929 rolled around, the Great Depression began. Both Charles and Esther lost their jobs, they mortgaged their home, they lost their car, they used up all their life savings. Charles was absolutely crushed, devastated. He sat around the house depressed until one day he told his wife she just needed to leave him because it was clear they were never going to reach their goal and he'd never amount to anything, so she might as well go find somebody else that could provide better for her than he could. Well, thank goodness, while he was being hopeless, she was being hopeful. You know, it's good to hang around with positive people. Because when you start kind of sliding down in the pit the devil's got dug for you, somebody else can reach down in there and lift you up. We all have times when we need somebody to encourage us. We all have times when we need people to say, hey, you can make it, it's going to be all right. Well, Esther wasn't about to leave. She told Charles, we're going to reach our goal. But she said, every day we need to do something to keep our dream alive. Keep it alive, Charles said. Well, it's dead. We've already failed. Esther refused to believe it. She suggested every night they take some time to discuss what they would do when they reached their goal of being millionaires. They began doing that each night after dinner. Soon Charles came up with the idea of creating play money. He said, we don't have any real money. Let's make some play money. Something quite appealing since money was so scarce in those days. So he sat around with lots of time now and lots of easy money because he made it all himself and he played with it. And he and his wife pretended to buy things like houses, property, and other buildings. So they finally turned it into a full-fledged game with board, dice, cards, little houses, and hotels. You guessed it, that was the beginning of a game you probably have in your closet right now called Monopoly. Charles's family and friends so enjoyed the game that in 1934 they persuaded him to approach the Massachusetts game firm Parker Brothers. Executives there played the game and rejected it. They found it dull, the action slow, and the rules hopelessly complex. Charles, however, persevered. His wife kept encouraging him, and he approached Wanamaker's toy store, told an executive if they would stock the game, he'd take out a loan and create 5,000 of them. The game took off, and suddenly Parker Brothers became very interested. They replayed the game, and this time they found out that it was imaginative, fast-paced, and surprisingly easy to master. Isn't it amazing when you're on the upswing how everybody wants to get on your train? The game was copyrighted in 1935, and you guessed it, they sold it to Parker Brothers for $1 million.